My cat is a core developer, specifically with creating a implementation of the Ethereum client in the esoteric programming language Brainfuck. So,
Yes, we know about that one.
yeah. So that's what my cat's up to.
Uh-oh. That would be a good language for cats, yes.
This is good start of the meeting. Starting in brain fight.
Definitely.
I woke up with 15 minutes to spare.
Nice. I woke up an extra hour, 20 minutes early because I thought that 1400 GMT was 8 a.m. my time, but it was actually 9.
Oh, there's things on the internet to make that really clear.
Yeah, I've heard. Don't know
Even
about.
Google, you type in 1400 UTC, it will tell you like what the right time is in your time zone. Unless you have your IP really like hidden away.
True. That is very true. Let's see. So let me attach the agenda. So that's going to be in
You prefer to
message.
suffer.
So I just put the agenda in Getter and on the internal chat here. So we'll wait just another second and then start on up.
Different than yesterday's agenda.
There's been just a couple of updates from Yoichi, and I'm in the process of editing the accepted EIPs because we forgot one from one of our discussions on Metropolis. Okay, so we have Parity, CPP, EVM, Ruby, Pytherium, Go, and I think that's it. So, hi, Andre. Which development team are you with?
C++ team. Hi, Hudson.
Oh, hi. Nice to meet you. Okay, yeah, I think I saw you on Skype.
God. You have cat tails, I have dog farts. No one else can hear them.
Yeah. And with that from Greg, we'll kick off this meeting. So the first agenda item is EIP signaling and voting system update. So me and Casey and I talked to some people from the Carbon Vote and Boardroom and MetaMask teams, and where we formed a group to create a voting system on blockchain that also connects to GitHub in order to show support by individual and by group for certain EIPs. So, yep, that's in progress, and some of the first looks at that are pretty good. And then, Casey, do you want to talk about the overall idea of your page that shows the implementations and which client it's implemented on?
I guess not too much to say really if you've already seen the table. It's not mandating that and you know, the client maintainers implement any particular RPC method, vote for an RPC method, you know, approves or adds or changes an RPC method, doesn't mandate that a maintainer of a client or a core dev, you know, has to follow that that specification. It just means that there will be a red mark in the table, is all.
Okay, cool. So yeah, it's
so that's about it.
Cool. Yeah, it's kind of like what's the other what's that kind of based off of, Casey? It's the who else uses that? Was it JavaScript, I guess?
Yeah, the ES6 compatibility table and stuff. It's linked in the EIP and in the issue.
Okay, great. I'll put that in the notes post meeting. Great. So next is going to be EIP 225. This is the Click Proof of Authority protocol and RinkB Proof of Authority testnet. So Peter, you can take it away on that.
Hey, I'm just going to link if anyone's wondering.
Sure.
So basically, it's kind of meant as a solution for our constant testnet problems. Last time we, so obviously Robstan blew up. We all know why it blew up. And the problem was last time we kind of agreed that maybe we should try to somehow revive it, but that didn't turn out to go so smoothly as we expected. And the problem is that even if we do try to somehow incentivize reviving Robstan, it will always be attackable if somebody really wants to do it. And maybe if we start up 10 GPUs, it can sustain some attacks, but if somebody really wants to break it, it can break it. And the problem is that kind of everybody was, the entire community blew up when Robstan went down because dev developers kind of rely on it to be able to test their stuff. So we, even though it's not proof of, most of the developers don't care what consensus engine testnet runs on as long as they can depend on it. Many people kind of started rolling their own private testnet. Mm-hmm. The Kovan appeared and others. It's a bit messy. And then the entire suggestion behind this EIP is that my suggestion is to relaunch a new testnet based on a very, very simplified proof of authority protocol. Now, the proof of authority protocol that I kind of call the Click is kind of, so the basic design principle behind the protocol was that we reuse as much as possible from the existing consensus system. Basically, it should be able to be integrated into existing clients with as little hassle as possible. And yet again, it should play along with all current technologies, light clients, fast sync, warp sync. It should not require client developers to kind of update their entire code base just to support this. And well, I won't go over the entire spec, but the idea is that, for example, the entire consensus protocol proof of authority is implemented. Mm-hmm. It's as part of the header fields. And there's a small voting mechanism so that signers can vote to add new signers or to drop existing signers. And the only field that is significantly changed, so to speak, extra data, but that field is dynamic in the original spec. I mean, in our current protocol, basically we can do whatever we want with that field because it doesn't break any rule, any networking rule, or serialization rule, etc. And the protocol is kind of, I won't go over the entire thing. You can read it. It's basically just a very simple, elegant proof of authority protocol that plays nice with everything. And just to point out, we did also an implementation in Go. I'm really proud that it's extremely self-contained. So the whole consensus engine is extremely commented, is 500 lines of code, and the whole voting mechanisms, again, extremely commented with some other stuff, is 200 lines of code. And basically, this is two files that can be plugged into the existing systems, and it kind of just works. And this was one of my core requirements, that it should be something that's trivial to add to all clients, because otherwise, if clients require a lot of work. I mean, client implementers, and it beats the purpose of running it as a testnet. So that's the TLDR.
Okay, cool. Is there any comments from other client devs, specifically if anyone has, you know, just initial thoughts on potentially implementing that into their client, and also if there's any concerns with this?
Arkady from Party here. So yeah, it looks reasonable enough. So we'll probably end up implementing Peter's proposal and also maintaining our own contract-based consensus engine for proof of authority. As for the time frame, it's hard to tell at this point. Couple of weeks, maybe.
Okay, thanks, Arkady. I guess that's we. Can... Yeah, and then Vitalik, are you back? Hey, Vitalik, can you hear us?
Yeah, I can hear you. I just switched to a better internet connection.
Oh, perfect. Okay, great. And then Jan, what are your thoughts on this?
Hi. I think once the standard is settled, the code should be fairly easy to implement in Python or Ruby.
Okay, excellent. So yeah, what we'll do is Peter's already written a really very well written EIP. We'll transfer, or I'll work with him to transfer that into a PR, and we'll do a final check over and pretty much consider it accepted. Christian, just to make sure CPP is on board with this, I thought I saw something in like a Gitter chat that y'all were good.
Yeah, sure. So we'll probably take longer than parity, but because we're focusing on Metropolis now. But yeah, looks good.
No problem. All right, great. So that one is accepted. We can move on to the next item, which is EIP 214. So this, I believe this is kind of shortened into static call versus peer call, where should static call do a state changing operation and actually throw, or just be reverted? So this was discussed a little bit on the channel by Nick or Martin. So I don't think I see Nick in here. Martin, could you elaborate on this and give your point of view?
Yeah, well, I guess it's basically since we have rebirth, it is possible to do a kind of synthetic pure call by having an initial bouncing through basically a reverting operation which returns the return value in the revert. So doing that kind of call will allow you to make pure calls that which are not hindered. So it's kind of an ugly backdoor into pure calls.
Hold on, do you mean pure call or static call?
I'm not sure which I mean.
Okay, so static call can read, but it can't write. Pure call can neither can't write and it also can't read.
Yeah, so this would be able to read. It would. They are right. Able to. They are kind of able to write, but anything they write will be reverted.
Okay. Wait, hold on.
So they can have.
Sorry. So how do you get the information out, but still do the revert anything that was written again?
Yeah, because the funny thing with the revert is that you're able to get a return. You can pass the return value as it was eventually defined.
Oh, I see. Interesting.
So you can bounce through a revert. And the effect you can have is that you can call stuff, and that stuff can store intermediary values during the calculation or whatever, and it can access the state. It can return, and then you revert the return value instead of returning. So
that does it's different functionality, right? Because in that kind of situation, the state could still change in the middle of the call, and so you could still have like weird reentrancy attacks through that.
Yeah. Well, no, because it would
be so I mean, like, what if you, no, but I mean, like, attacks where, let's say, A, like, A calls B, and that call is supposed to be a static call, but then B calls A, and then A calls B, and then that does some state changes. And, like, basically then, like, the inner call makes some state changes, and that influences the outer call.
Yeah, but if the envelope call is going to revert anyway.
Well, no, but the point basically is that the outer call... So let's say the outer call, so in my case B, has some state, and the process of calling the function starts changing some state. Then let's say at some point, then after that it calls A, and then A calls B again, and then that changes a bunch of state. Then after that, once the execution goes back to B, like the execution of B is going to continue, but the state will have been changed in the middle. So it's like a revert. It's a reentrancy attack that's like one level deeper in.
Yeah, I'm not sure I follow you, but so the point I was making is that as soon as we implement the revert opcode, and Nick pointed this out also, then it will be possible to kind of abuse the revert functionality in order to obtain side effect free calls. And do we want all these different kind of mechanisms?
Right, I see. Okay. You know, think about it. It might actually not be an issue.
No, it might not be. It's just an open question on the Awkward Devs channel.
Right. Now, actually, I mean, if I can't think of any problems with that, then that definitely does seem like an interesting way of doing static call.
I think there are two reasons against it.
Mm-hmm.
And one of them is you will end up with two calls. So essentially, the proposal here was that in your contract, if you're trying to call something with static call to another contract, first you will call yourself another function on your contract, which mm-hmm. does the call and does the revert. And the second reason is if we have the actual static call, then with static analyzers, you could be sure that it will be a static call, right? Otherwise,
so the thing that you would do with static analyzers here is you would do a call, and then you would do an assert that says that the result of the call, that the value that was popped onto the stack by the stack opcode basically said that it got reverted. So one thing that does concern me, though, is that if you start using it in that way, then you can't really distinguish. Like, if the revert opcode pushes a zero onto the stack, then you can't distinguish between successful reverts and exceptions inside of the call. So, like, it would almost seem better to push a two onto the stack or something else, or as
Well,
revert that inside the forwarder, right? I mean, the forwarder always succeeds, and the fact whether the internal call succeeded or not will be part of the return data of the revert.
Kind of, but like even there's still going to be cases where you can't really distinguish. Basically, if the internal call fails, right, then it's you can't really tell the difference between that and it returning zero data.
Yeah, there was a separate proposal to change the return value of call to have three states.
Yeah, okay, I fully support that. Yes, I support that. So, and that would totally fix this issue.
But that's not something we have planned for Metro, right? Having three return values for call.
I mean, it's something that would be trivial to implement if we agree on it.
Yeah, but it would be, it's definitely not backwards compatible.
Well, hold on. So the revert opcode right now doesn't exist, right? So
if the revert opcode.
No, I thought we were talking about what call returns.
Yeah. Right. So what call returns is not that easy to change because of all the existing Solidity contracts.
Right, but I mean, what if we have zero representing an actual throw, one representing a correct output, and then the number two representing the revert opcode, then shouldn't that solve it in a totally backwards compatible way?
Current Solidity contracts check for non-zero.
Yeah, so that's fine. Because like if it, unless, oh, I see, because
of the failure.
Right, so the challenge here is that the throw opcode has two use cases, where one of them is to signal a failure, and one of them would be to abuse it in this way to return a static value.
So let's start from further back. So revert with returning data only makes sense if we have at least return data size, and perhaps even return data copy.
Why?
Because the success type, the success data type and the failure data type, these are two different things. And
right.
They can have different sizes, so we need dynamic returns.
Sure. Although, we can still do it with, I think for most use cases, the a failure return data type just being 32 bytes should be enough, right? Cases that require the failure return to be like variable size seem limited.
But then you need, assuming we have return data size, then
right.
We can use that to distinguish throw from revert.
True.
Throw will not provide data, and revert will, or I mean, revert without data is basically the same as just the throw.
Right. So, what would the assert be after a call? Then would it say returns? Would it check the stack value for one, and then or that with the return data size, or?
So what's the exact question?
So how would high level programming languages implement that and work with all of these things?
Are you talking about the static call workaround or other solution? Or
Kind of both at the same time. So the static call workaround use case and the use case of using throw to actually signal an error.
So the just regular throw revert mechanism. Yeah, that has not been worked out correctly how to do that.
But you're basically
in AI level language, but basically, you check for failure, and in the case of failure, you just access the return data, and that goes into some kind of exception object.
Mm-hmm.
That's it.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it's a bit unfortunate that one is success.
Yeah, so is this all just for me to kind of keep up with that? Is this all relating to EIP 214, or is this a culmination of EIPs that build on each other?
It's, I think, a combination.
Okay, sounds good. So, 214 is the new opcode static call, and it sounds like based on that, other things might need to change. Would someone be able to cross-reference these EIPs in the repository? And what I mean by that is either tag them across each other or give an outline more or less of what was discussed today?
I think we didn't discuss more than is already written in the issues, did we?
Let me look. that's the thing. I haven't looked through all of these EIPs. Potentially. So what we can do is we can bring this up in the next all-core dev meeting. But this, I think someone mentioned, this isn't something that's going into Metro, right?
No, I think it is, isn't it? It's done for now.
So the question is, So the proposal was to not include static call because it can be simulated by other mechanisms, which will probably make their way into Metropolis.
Yeah. So one kind of side question, are we also interested in pure call? And
I mean, pure call is fundamentally different because it it doesn't call into another address, right? But I mean, it's very useful, different. I would say, right?
Yeah, I mean, like it does require some of the machinery because, like, in the case of static call, you have to do something to either disable or throw on any write operations, and in the case of pure call, you have to do the same thing for both writes and reads, or. But although I guess doing just one is definitely simpler than doing both. So, okay, so like I personally definitely feel a bit more comfortable with return data size if it means that we can kind of simulate static call without actually doing static call.
So I think it would be good to code up a specific example of how to do that exactly.
Sure. Yeah.
Yeah, that sounds like a good idea. Would that have to be across multiple clients or just one example that everyone...
By code up, do you mean like an implementation inside of Ethereum code, or do you mean like an implementation of how that gets used in high-level code?
No, I was thinking about an assembly implementation.
Oh, yeah. So in that case, it will be done in like Serpent or Solidity Assembly or LLL or whatever.
Yeah. So the high-level thing... I think that needs to be discussed in separately, but it's a bit. Mm-hmm. The main problem here is that when you look at Solidity, you can't really distinguish an internal from an external call. Mm-hmm. And the mechanism is, of course, different for internal and external calls, so that might be a bit complicated, but yeah, we have to see.
Okay, sounds good. So, to give a summary, Casey and Alex in the chat put some of the ones that cross-reference this issue a little bit, and Christian, would you all be able to do that implementation you were talking about and just kind of post that across the EIPs and maybe the Gitter channels?
Sure.
Okay, great. Casey just had a comment. Yeah, we can move it into the under consideration table. That's a good idea. So that they can all be in there, and then we can concatenate any that we need to. So, any other comments on this? Cool. Okay. Oh, and then Alex, you typed in chat something. Did you have a comment?
Well, no, it's just Casey said if maybe we should move pure static call revert and data size into under consideration for Metropolis. But I think revert itself is standalone.
Yeah, exactly. Like revert is seems very uncontroversial, and it's useful even if none of the other stuff gets implemented.
Okay, sounds good. But if it is dependent on return data size.
Yeah, I thought Christian said that revert isn't very useful without return data size and return data copy.
At least depends it's much on more the useful. Case. Yeah, it's much more useful when we also have these other two.
Okay, so let's keep it as accepted then.
Okay, sounds good. Yeah, so it's useful with other things, but it can also stand on its own even without those. Okay, sounds good. Cool. I think that's all the comments for this. So the next item is EIP 161. I believe that's kind of already dealt with more or less. Yoichi, do you want to just do a brief summary of what you commented on in the agenda page and how that's being resolved?
Oh, yeah, sure. So basically, it's about the yellow paper status. And about Metropolis, things look good. but there are other bad stuff. Good news first. For Metropolis, I've created pull requests for most Metropolis EIPs, except elliptic curves. And I visited Gavin's office, and with him I discussed Metropolis PRs. And now it's clear to me what he wants, what he doesn't want. So things look good there. But I have to do a little heads up here, because the yellow paper on the master branch currently is still at Homestead. So even before Spurious Dragon, the previous fork, I once submitted the Spurious Dragon pull request, Gavin merged it, but he reverted the changes. And he says he wants some cleanup first. And Gavin said he and I should meet more frequently. So we will be meeting regularly, working on the yellow paper together. And a background to all this is the yellow paper is not under an open source license or Creative Commons one, no license. So it's just Gavin's authorship and some other contributors' copyrights. So I need to keep working with him, and I will be persistent about that.
Okay, sounds good. I saw that, and I just want to know if this is... Oh, go ahead.
So yeah, I had an additional concern about EIP 161 that was on the...
Oh, that's exactly what I was going to bring up. Yeah, I was going to go to your comment and get her, but go ahead, Arkady.
Okay. So EIP 161 allows to delete empty accounts, but it does not clearly specify if a pre-compiled contract account can be considered empty when it doesn't have any storage. So my interpretation is that it cannot, because it contains native code. And this is not an issue for the main Ethereum network currently, because all of the precompiles have some balance currently there. But it might be an issue for future networks, the new testnet or the private network, whatever. And it would be good to clarify that and specify it in the yellow paper as well.
I can explain the yellow paper status. In my previous Dragon pull request, it's specified that the precompiles can be empty. Their code is empty, and they can be removed. And then I believe that's what other implementations do currently. OK, well, about this proposal, it's very easy in the yellow paper to implement this particular proposal so that precompiles cannot be empty. So as far as the yellow paper is concerned, whichever is fine if consensus is gained.
OK. And
a question related to that. I'm assuming that they won't be existing in the state try, though, right?
So the code, the native code, this thing will not be in the state try. You are right. So the way to distinguish that is actually, so there must be an in-protocol mechanism to distinguish precompiles and non-precompiles. Otherwise, we cannot distinguish empty usual accounts or empty precompiles. So we need a mechanism to specify which address contains precompiles.
Well, if all the implementations already go with that they can be empty, it might be reasonable to just keep up with the de facto standard. But I would like to confirm that this is really the case. So I looked at the Go Ethereum code, and this seems to be the case.
So yeah, so it that was the case before the Dragon hard fork, and I think I don't see the issue with keeping it, although like implementation has to consider like having empty contract that can actually return some data in calls. But that was the case before the hard fork, and I don't really see the reason for the change.
Yeah, so what is the reason? Sorry, Peter, you can go ahead.
No, I just wanted to say that I haven't checked that part of the code for a long time in Go Ethereum, but I think there was at a given point there was a mini fork in mainnet when Geth and Parity went two different directions, and then it turned out that both the clients had some bug. And as far as I know, the issue was that Go Ethereum did not delete something because it had a rule that precompiles cannot be deleted while Parity deleted it. So I'm not sure whether we delete it or not, but I kind of agree with Arkady that this is kind of a weird corner case, and it would be nice to specify, especially if you want clients to play nicely on non-main network too.
More precisely, this consensus issue was about out of gas happening during precompiled execution. So after the previous Dragon contained empty account removal thing, empty accounts were removed when they were touched. And the question was, when a contract was being executed, but out of gas happens, the question is if this contract is touched or not touched when the out of gas happened. And usually when out of gas happens, everything should be reverted. So state removal shouldn't happen and the account was not touched. But for precompiles, it was different. And that's the state now. So we currently have an exception on precompiles that if out of gas happens during precompiled contract execution, they are touched and their state might be cleared.
I have a question about how can this, I don't understand how this can be a problem on private networks since we don't create empty accounts. But I'm missing something, but I don't know what I'm missing.
No, this is only a problem if people start creating a new network with homestead rules, for instance, and then create empty accounts and then do the cleanup. If people start with after Spurious Dragon rules, then, I mean, they will never see an empty account. So,
right. Yeah, right, but if we implement this, this will be part of a hard fork. So, I mean, we can't retroactively implement this. I don't really understand.
People can start private networks with pre-Spurious Dragon rules and set up empty accounts. That's the only case.
And personally, I think that over time we should be deprecating support for old rule sets more and more, right? So, like, I don't see much of a need for supporting people making hard forks with pre-Spurious Dragon rules, with people making private chains with pre-Spurious Dragon rules.
Agreed.
Okay, so it sounds like then that would just be a clarification at the yellow paper level and. An assurance that all the clients are now in compatibility, which I believe was fixed during the hard fork around November, I guess Thanksgiving time. I think there was a pre-compile that was deleted on mainnet. Is that correct?
Yeah.
Okay, cool.
Yeah, a question, though, regarding private networks. Should it be assumed that this... the hard forks are dependent on each other? I mean, if only Spurious Dragon is specified from block zero, should it be assumed that all the previous hard forks also are applied at that level.
We had a discussion about exactly this with Jeff and Felix a few days ago. He's reworking our Genesis handling. And what Jeff's proposal was that how it would be so awesome if people could turn on and off individual soft forks. But in my opinion, the problem that this is that this will open up a huge can of worms if there's some unforeseen dependency between hard forks. It could really mess things up.
So the implementation in C++ is also assuming strictly ascending hard forks.
Yeah, it would be good just, it's not hard. It's not critical, but it would be good if there was some general consensus about that.
Oh, Vitalik, could you mute?
Sorry, hold on.
Okay, so it sounds like, I don't think this is requiring of an EIP because this was more or less dealt with in one of the last hard forks, so... I think everyone, am I right to say that pretty much everyone's in agreement of how the changes are going to go, and it's more, I guess at this point, if we're all trying to figure out if it's worth it to do backwards compatibility for this, if someone wants to pick and choose what previous hard fork changes they want to put in their private network. So are we kind of more or less saying we don't really want to go that path because it overcomplicates future improvements?
I'm not a client developer. I'd be interested in hearing what Peter and Vitalik says about it. And Chris, whoever.
Yeah, I guess it doesn't matter that much, but it would still be nice to clarify that in the yellow paper. Just update it to the current state of the implementation.
Okay, great. So yeah, it sounds like the spec is important to be updated. Oh, go ahead, Peter.
No, I just wanted to say that the only thing if we do specify that they can only occur incrementally and you cannot cherry pick whatever you want, I think the benefit of that would be easier reasoning about security of the entire chain.
Okay, sounds good. So, we'll do the update to the yellow paper. Is there any other comments on this? Otherwise, I think it's pretty much resolved.
So I will clarify that in the previous Dragon pull request, I'm trying again.
I think he cut off there at the end, Yoichi. Repeat that one more time.
Ah, okay. So I will clarify this point in my Spurious Dragon pull request that I'm trying to fight again.
Oh, great. Okay, sounds good. The next item is... Okay, that was 4. 5 is the Metropolis updates and finding a central location to document EIPs going into Metro. So in the Gitter channel, I will repost this, but I posted... 3 links, and then Casey added a 4th for where EIPs should go, and let me get the 4th one real quick. So basically, there is a list from Parity within their GitHub PR system or issue system. There's a list from Geth, I believe it's a pull request, and then there is a page on the PM repo that has it was a really old list of all of them, so that's inaccurate. I'll be updating it. And then I feel like the one that is the most updated is the link Casey posted, which was the EIPs page, accepted EIPs plan for adoption. So if everyone can go there, it has a list of EIPs ready or that are planned for adoption and are in the process of being implemented. So looking at this across the other clients that are implementing this, it's mostly the same list. Does anybody see one that's missing or any comments about the ones that are added? I think they've all been accepted in previous calls, but we may have to check on that and clarify that in future calls. Yeah, because it looks like, I think at least in the case of parity, 86 and 96 are not in their list for the Metro release. So I was wondering about that. If you could comment, Arkady.
I'm pretty sure they are. Maybe check the numbers in brackets, because some of these have.
Yep, I see. Yeah, I see, because, yeah, the numbering is weird. Okay, thank you. I see, yeah. And then let me just look at Geth real quick just to make sure that all of those are correctly in there as well. So we have 198, 140, 98. The pairing precompile return data. Okay. I think they have all of them. Go ahead, Casey.
Maybe we'll just add a column to that table with that contains short links to, you know, to each client pull request, you know, where the implementation is taking place.
Okay, great. I guess lastly, Jan, I think you have a PR or a issue that lists all this, right? Or maybe I saw that for something else.
A PR set up for what?
For the Metropolis changes. So just the EIPs and their level of implementation per client.
I don't think so. I have no PR set up for, you mean Ruby client?
Yeah. All right. That or Python. I just hadn't looked at them.
No, there's no one in Python set up for Metropolis, I think.
Okay, no problem. Yeah. I was just going to check so we could add that link or not. Okay, cool. Any other comments on the list of accepted EIPs planned for adoption?
Yeah, I was going to mention that, you know, it helps to use descriptive titles in the, you know, in the pull request that people open, you know, to... that specifies the EIP, because then that title, whatever title is used in the EIP, then, you know, it then goes into the table. And so where the titles were too short or undescriptive, like EIP 86, I took some liberty and inserted, you know, what I thought was a more descriptive title.
Okay, great. Yeah, I think that's a good idea. Everyone who's doing some of the EIP PRs, that's a good tip to help them be a little bit more clear. I believe there's, so I didn't actually add this to the agenda because I just realized this is still something that needs to be brought up, but there's a list of EIPs under consideration. So I know 211, which was the return data size and return data copy, is still, you know, being discussed. But EIP5, gas usage for return and call, what's the status of that, Christian? Has that, I guess I forgot if we've talked about it in a previous call or if there is a status on it.
So my preference would be to replace that by return data copy and return data size, but yeah.
Oh, okay. So it's not even really
needed. Vitalik voiced a different opinion in the last meeting.
Ah, got it. So yeah, any updates on your opinion, Vitalik, or was that kind of related to the previous discussion we had in this meeting?
Yeah, my opinion on which topic?
Whether or not... on the EIPs under consideration on the README, the 211 is what we discussed earlier. Another one is EIP5. Gas usage for return and call, and you, I think Christian right, was saying that, yeah, you were more fond
yeah,
of five.
I mean, I still feel like 5 is simpler than, and more ideal than 211. I mean, I'd be willing to go with 211 if it also means that we can get rid of static call, though I think there might also be an even cleaner way to do like 5 and accomplish the same goal as static call in some other way. Like, basically, my main concern is that we should be trying to, like, minimize opcode inflation as much as possible.
Okay, sounds good. Okay, so that's going to still be under discussion then. Let's try to think a little bit more on that, and next all core devs call start to come to a resolution, I would recommend, just because of the timing for the Metropolis things. Speaking of which, I believe, Greg, did you have a comment?
Yeah, I don't care about opcode inflation per se, but I don't have the feeling that this little collection of opcodes is sort of a logically consistent and minimal little system yet.
Yeah, like, it's for me personally, opcode inflation is maybe not the right word. Like, I can handle opcodes, but the thing that may be uneasy about return data size is it adds also another data structure into the computational state. So, like, it's also that kind of, so it's like another sort of unique dimension to complexity in some ways.
Yeah, but it can simplify other things.
Right. Yeah, I mean, I can see that.
But we have to pull it all together. They're sort of unrelated proposals that haven't been pulled together.
Right. Yeah, like, maybe we need to kind of come up with a few competing alternatives for, like, how all of these things mesh with each other. There's clearly interdependencies.
Would it make sense to have a concentrated call on these issues somehow at some point?
That seems sensible.
Or like a kind of research meeting or whatever.
I mean, we could even just have an ongoing Skype chat over the next 2 weeks.
Yep.
Yeah, that definitely sounds reasonable. And another thing, the ongoing text discussion and then someone starting calls if needed. The other thing is, it sounds like part of the way to alleviate the confusion is to start coming up with, like, a couple of paragraphs of different, I kind of see it as, you know, EIPs building off each other and proposals building off each other. So making sure that's all understood. A lot of the time when we're talking about these things, we're saying, you know, it's dependent on the rest of these either being implemented or the way we're going to implement some of these other things. So getting a clear understanding of that, I'm not sure the best way to do that. I guess the ongoing Skype chat is probably the easiest.
Mm-hmm.
Cool. Okay. So, yeah, what we'll do is I will send out a link on Gitter about the ongoing Skype chat related to this. I'll just go ahead and set that up between Chris, Greg, and Vitalik, and then anyone else who wants to can join based on that Gitter link.
Mm-hmm.
Great. Vitalik, you had mentioned somewhere online that because of, it was either the price increase or something else, I guess we have a little bit more time until the block times are adjusted.
Yes. Actually, like, again, probably run through the math right now again, because it changes literally day by day. So the most recent difficulty is, hold on, ETHstats is being slow. I'm not even sure why I'm using ETHstats.
I didn't even think ETHstats was... Oh, yeah, ETHstats is kind of wonky right now, I think.
Okay, hold on. I'll just use my light node. Okay, 195 trillion. So that's even higher than the last time I did this. Okay. And 195 trillion, so that means our hash power is 14 trillion. Then block number 3368795. Hold on, date plus percent s, fetch the current timestamp. Running the script thing again. Yeah, so by the end of June, the block time is only going to be around 19.5 seconds. By the end of August, it's only going to be about 28.5 seconds. So, like, I think we still have, like, it's still, but basically, if we get it out before the end of June, it's even better. And if we get it out before the end of August, it's still, like, less bad.
Okay.
So, like, my recommendation is probably still, like, end of June as a kind of normal case target and end of August as a worst case deadline. But, like, basically the conditions that NOR users would have to go would be end up living through in either case or continue to get better and better.
Okay, cool. And is that in any way dependent on the price increase or?
Yes. Okay. So in general, the difficulty of a blockchain is a kind of very lagging moving average of the price. So I would say, first of all, in any the probability is probably like less than 10% that difficulty will ever go down again. Like it's almost certainly going to be above 200. So then the question is this the top and is it going to crash back down to 20 to 30, in which case I could see difficulty topping off and maybe the 250, like the 300 range. Is it going to stay the same as it is now, in which case we could see difficulty being in the 400 to 500 range? Is it going to still keep going up? I mean, potentially, like, if in the kind of sky-high scenario where Ethereum takes over Bitcoin entirely, we could literally see this delayed until... Actually, let me see what happens if I just multiply hash power by another factor of 10. Yeah, so in that extreme case, at the end of June, the block time is still 15 seconds, and at the end of August, it goes up to 21. And only at the end of the year, it goes up to about 43. So we basically the better we do, the more time we have. I would say in the more kind of in my personal estimation of the kind of 50-50 case, I can probably run through that right now. So that would be difficulty in maybe topping off at 500 billion in this maybe. Middle of the summer or so. That would be, or even just to be fair, let's say 420 billion. That would get us to, also 19 seconds at the end of June, but then the 19 seconds would keep on going all the way up until the middle of July.
Maybe we should switch our efforts from implementing the EIPs to pumping the price.
Yay, let's get linear results for exponential work.
On a related note.
No.
You go ahead.
I was just thinking, I think I was just wondering whether or not us DOSing our own blockchain and slowing down the block time would also help. But I think that might be maybe it might. The practical thing to do, I think, is to just, like, keep our heads down and see if we can finish this by the end of June.
Yeah. Yeah, we can always try. But one thing I would like to... mention to all the people who are implementing these EIPs, because mm-hmm. When you do that, you find edge cases and you think about edge cases and you maybe even make test cases for these. But if they're documented, so we make sure that they become consensus tests in the actual Ethereum test repository also, mm-hmm. So we have a good test coverage of this, because yeah. There's a lot of changes.
Yes,
and it's difficult for Dmitry to keep up with all the changes. Totally. So this needs to be a concerted effort. That's it. Mm-hmm. All right, did we lose Hudson?
Oh, can you hear me now?
Yes.
Ah, no, yeah, my microphone went on mute. So, no, I was saying, so Martin, when you were talking about that, did you mean people should write their EIPs very specifically and mention edge cases, or just...
No, no, I meant that we need to make sure during the process of implementing these EIPs, developers need to make sure that all these weird edge cases that they come up with, that they're submitted so that they become test cases, so that all the stuff we learn while implementing it can benefit the other clients, and we don't have any consensus issues, because they make sure they wind up in the Ethereum tests repository.
Okay, excellent. Is there a formal process or even just an informal process best way to get these to Dimitri or to whoever needs it?
I don't think there's a formal process. The informal one is to just ping him or me or anyone in the... There's a Skype channel, Ethereum Dev Tests, and there's... I'm guessing all core devs would work also. Or Wins Vega on Twitter.
Okay, yeah, I'll talk to him about getting a more concerted effort. Peter?
I just wanted to add to that I think one of the problems with this, it's a really noble cause. One of the problems that I see for client developers is that, for example, when modifying or building previous forks, often we made a modification and it turned out that we couldn't sync testnet because something we changed something, but the error wasn't caught by the test suite. And then obviously the no-brainer would have been to just submit a new test to the test suite. But the problem is that it's so complicated and messy to create a new test that nobody really bothers. So probably a long-term solution or long-term suggestion from my part would be if we could somehow create a small tool that allows a simple way to make tests so that if I know that this is my corner case, so that I can somehow transform that into a test easily without having to manually create everything, all the blocks and all the stuff.
Yeah, you're totally right, Peter. And definitely that's something that should be. But in the meantime, I wasn't meaning that everyone needs to submit actual test cases. Just document the scenarios or the corner cases and... for the last hard fork, I think we set up one of those, what's it called? So we just type the cases into the paper pad, something like that. Just something like that, short description, verbal description. So then Dimitri or someone else can take over and make an actual test case out of it. That's what I'm talking about.
Okay, sounds good. Yeah, and I think over time there'll be more, like a more clean process, like the kind Peter's referring to. So yeah, I'm sure Dimitri would be very happy with that suggestion.
Hmm.
Okay, so any other comments on that?
Just a short comment. EXIG already wrote the static call via revert solution. It's a comment on the pull request.
Oh yeah, and it's also a GitHub gist in this chat in this chat room we're currently in. Damn, Alex, you work fast. Okay, so yep, I think that's actually all the agenda items. Let me just double check. But was there anything else from anybody? I think this is good. What we'll do is for the last item, I guess, was just where are we going to put all the Metropolis stuff. We'll use the README page on EIP. So if you just go to the EIP's repo, it's the first page on there. So it'll say under consideration or accepted, and that's what we'll go with for now. And yeah, just a reminder, if y'all have any EIPs you want to throw in, please add them to the agenda. I usually try to set that up at least a week before. I'll start doing it right after meetings, though. And I'll release the audio and some notes on this sometime later today, hopefully. So, yep, good meeting, everybody. See y'all next time.
See ya.
See ya.
Bye.
Thank you.
Bye.
Bye-bye.
Thank you.